Testing 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, 21. 34, 55, 89. Who's here? Hey, Dave. Welcome to Tuesday. 26th of June. Looks like I'm starting my London Lens session here the same way we started yesterday's London Lens session. Signs of, at least some signs of dollar strength, particularly against the euro. Signs of yen strength, which I'll get to in a moment. First, let me remind you the purpose of FX Bootcamp is education. This is not an alert service. The currency coaches do not make trade recommendations, but we do provide real-time technical and fundamental analysis at least 14 hours each trading day. If you're trading with us using a demo account, then regardless of whether or not your trade plans are successful, you will have an opportunity to learn. Remember that investing and trading is risky business, and Forex you use some leverage, but don't overdo it. As a novice trader, the leverage can work for you, but often it works against you, so please do not risk money you cannot afford to lose. Hey, Paul, and greetings, Alex. Interesting illustration, though, I must say, of relative strength here. You see some strength in the dollar, but it's not broadly based, and it's not overwhelming, you might say. Look at the, let me activate the drawing tool first here. You know, I kind of got away from my pink marker yesterday. And I must say, I've got to get back to it. Kind of miss it. So I'm going to activate to get that going. So you see that the euro down over the past, 90 minutes? Actually, you notice the euro has made new lows for the day. I know it's perking up right now a little bit, but euro made new low for the day. By comparison, look at cable. Up and just much smaller dip. Aussie. Up, and some firmness in the dollar did drag the Aussie down, but not nearly as much as did the euro. In fact, look at them. To really give you a different perspective, let's switch to hourly charts for the euro and say the Aussie. To get a look at price action over a longer span of time. There you go. This shows price action since last Friday. So you see the yesterday's drop, which I'm highlighting now. Rise during, I believe, the yesterday's New York afternoon, and what, to some extent, perhaps the early part of today's Asian session, and the recent drop here. By comparison, look what the Aussie's done. The Aussie has managed to recoup all of yesterday's losses. Yeah, so it's... Dave says it's more of your weakness, and yeah, seems to be the story. By the way, a similar comparison can be drawn with cable. Doing this just to point out it's not just a necessarily a strong Aussie story. You don't have any obvious gaps from last Friday's close to Monday's early Asian session open the way you did on the euro and I believe on the Aussie. But you can see here, where's my drawing tool again? Here we go. You know, we're down yesterday on cable, and cable's really, really gone up. In fact, as I speak, we're in the vicinity on cable of today's highs. Not too terribly far from Friday's highs there. In fact, closing in on a green trend line. We'll take a look at what that green trend line's all about here in just a minute. Let me set these charts back in place first. While I do that, I'll note that the not a lot happening at the moment anyway in the major European markets. I'm referring to not just the major equity market indices such as Germany's DAX or the France's CAC 40, but even the government bond markets are a little bit subdued today. Oh, I promise you, look at that trend line for cable. There you go. We've discussed a similar trend line on pairs like the Euro USD, a trend line in this case defined by the June 1st low, actually the post NFP low. Non-farm payrolls report released on Friday, June 1st, the low established minutes after the release of that report. I've just circled there, and you've got a swing low right there. Now you could argue the real trend line is a little bit higher based on a different series of higher lows, which I'm beginning to circle now. I won't argue with you. But what I'm struck by is that you do have a recent high or a recent low and recent highs, which seem to respect that trend line, at least temporarily. So perhaps that's an issue. Plus, even if that trend line's a bit of a fictional sort of thing in my mind, you also have actually, let me recast the drawing. I mean, reset the drawing tool so I can draw attention to this. I see a low. Hang on a minute. Low there, highs there. So you got that going on. And why do I think that's we're nearing, or maybe very close to, or at maybe even at a 38.2% Fib retracement level of the move down from the high there, which I've labeled number one, to the low here, which I'm labeling number two. I'm going to draw that Fib study now. Sure enough, we're about right there, very close to it. Oh, Kevin mentions daily R2. Haven't even looked at pivot point yet. So that's another nice compliment to that level. Before I move on to the end crosses, we'll check those charts with pivot points and other indicators for cable. Oh, to clarify, it doesn't mean cable can't run higher. Just means there's plenty of things in place for bears to justify a short. Let's look at the cable charts here. Hello, Jaime. Okay, here we got charts with indicators, including pivot points, daily, weekly, and monthly pivot points, that is, on the hourly chart in the middle of this view. You see a somewhat thick horizontal bright red line, which I'm pointing to now. That's the daily R2 pivot point. Kevin also mentioned a weekly central pivot point, which you could just make out in the top of the 4-hour chart right there. So yeah, there's some things going on in this 56.25 zone. The British pound's relative strength notwithstanding, it's not crazy if you're a bear. to look for a short in this region. Oh, and the yen crosses. Let's take a look at the Japanese yen. Actually, let's start instead with a look at some USD pairs, including the dollar yen. Because I do want to emphasize some price action on the dollar yen first. Anyone recall my mention of the 79.75 area yesterday? I'm expanding the chart for the dollar yen. Let's make this a 4-hour chart. We talked about the mid-June highs. Horizontal green line crossing near the middle of this chart. That horizontal green line at 79.75. You got the mid-June highs at or very close to that level, which I'm highlighting now, those highs. We broke that, which I'm pointing to now. We, on the right-hand side of the chart, we broke that level during yesterday's New York session. What's interesting to me, look at this. Hopefully at least one of the other coaches discussed this. Notice the after the break during today's Asian and London sessions, notice the retest. That's plural, by the way, retests of that 79.75 level. That is the basis, by the way, or that could have been at least part of the basis for longing the Japanese yen against other major currencies like the Aussie, like the Euro yen. So I'm talking about like an Aussie yen short, a Euro yen short, things like that. Oh, another thing to notice, we just hit a green trend line. Let's look back at that 4-hour chart and check the basis for the basis for that. I believe I drew this green trend line on the chart yesterday. The post NFP low on established on June 1st. We talked about low established on June 1st on cable. Similar sort of thing was established on this pair, dollar yen. This is a 4-hour chart showing price action going back to late May. See some higher lows established in mid-June. And lows in here as well. Interesting how we bounced right there just moments ago. You know, if you project backward in time, this recent low. You know, this area has been an issue in the past. You see that? Now, news flow could have contributed at least in part to this rallying the Japanese yen. Well, now, some of you may have noticed that Japan's lower house of parliament, after several months of wrangling about this, they did manage to pass some legislation in Japan's lower house of parliament. That is, there's it's a 5% sales tax. I'm sorry, the Japan doubled their previous 5% sales tax. The reason why it's the yen positive, well, some of you already know, Japan's public finance is not in such good shape. Country has extremely high debt to GDP level. And so as maybe one small baby step towards at least moderately improving public finances, the Prime Minister, formerly, by the way, who was formerly the Minister of Finance, Noda was pushing and managed to get Parliament, lower house that is, to pass a sales tax for the country, or a boost to the sales tax in the country. So perhaps the at least part of the reason for today's yen rally is that news out of Japan. for you dollar yen bears, and by the way, this pair certainly is tradable. Or even if you're not a dollar yen bear, but trading the other yen crosses. If we do see the yen weaken again against the dollar, at least temporarily, I'd watch this area. 7940-ish area. Actually, even it's a 15-minute chart for the dollar yen. Even some temporary lows there as well. So what I'm pondering is the possibility of something like this. Retracement of today's earlier drop. Retest the 79.40 to 45 zone, whatever that is. And then perhaps a continuation lower. So we got a battle going on here. Again, this let me reset this drawing tool. This 79.20-ish area, as I mentioned earlier, has been important. In fact, I should put a line on this chart there. Again, the 79.20 area important early, going back, looking back at the this entire month of trading. Plus, we got again the green trend line there. But yet, this 79.40 to 45 area has been important more recently. So, we got a battle zone going on here. We'll see who wins. We're going to try to fit a line here to that. $79.20 area. I'm going to make it a line at $79.25. Let's make it purple too. Not crazy if you put the line at 79.20 instead. The lows I mentioned established earlier this month are closer to like about 79.15. So actually maybe what I would do in this case, I'd shift that line down to 79.20. Almost like you've got a zone 79.20 plus or minus 5 pips, which again has had a notable effect on price action. There we go. Add another line. I mentioned the 79.40 to 45 area. I'll make this line orange. Correction, dark orange. All right. Battle zones defined on dollar yen. Oh, by the way, again, I haven't even looked at indicators. Cable making a new high. Signs of renewed dollar weakness across the board. Yeah, Dave mentions the cable at that weekly central now. also in this in the vicinity of that trend line I mentioned earlier. Aussie near its highs for the day as well. Want to take a closer look at the euro. Yesterday I mentioned this area here. The 124.40 to 1.2450 area, which had been important in the first half of the month. We haven't quite gotten there. Perhaps it's only a matter of time. We're starting to see this a pattern here. A pattern I've seen on many pairs and on a, on many occasions. By the way, this is a 4-hour chart. 4-hour chart for the Euro USD going back to late May. You see what I'm pointing to now, a sharp sell-off late last week. That was on Thursday. We had a batch of bad data. China PMI. What else was it on last Thursday? They're gonna some PMI numbers out of Europe that weren't so good. Some flash PMI numbers during the European session, and then we had a poor Philly Fed report during last Thursday's New York morning session, all benefiting the dollar. And the Euro USD broke its own green trend line defined by the June 1st low there, and a higher low established around mid-June right there. So here's the break of the green trend line. But here's my point. The pattern of price action, which I've certainly seen before, maybe if some of you have well, it goes is it's like a two-phase pattern. You get a initial sharp sell-off, which I'm pointing to now, followed by, seems you can make a case for a sort of a descending channel here. It seems to be what we're in right now. And the debate is, do are we is this the descending channel nearing its end? I mean, I have to notice that we have yesterday's low here, and perhaps a higher low in there. From here, maybe a break above the channel. And I admit that a dead channel defined a bit loosely, but seems plausible that the channel's been at work there. Cable continues to march higher. I should add that there's some officials from the Bank of England that have been on the news wires lately playing down the prospect of a rate cut. Mervyn King, the Bank of England governor, for example, spoke or was reported about 40 minutes ago that Bank of England governor Mervyn King spoke. King was saying that he had not completely rejected calls to cut the bank rate, the Bank of England's main interest rate, but King went on to say that arguments against a rate cut below 0.5% continue to apply. And by the way, there was also some references early, I believe, to a I believe it's German economists. German economists surveyed are increasingly calling for an ECB rate cut. Let me see if I find the reference to that survey. Yeah, according to a poll, 53% of German bank economists want the ECB to lower rates at its next meeting in early July. Well, going back to the Bank of England, MPC member Miles was also talking recently, within the past hour apparently. Miles expresses doubt that an interest rate cut would do any good. I don't know, maybe those comments are helping give the British pound a boost, if only moderately. I'll take a closer look at the cable charts, but I first want to pay some more attention to this Aussie here. You can see last Friday's high. The high established last Friday, late last Friday. This was during the New York afternoon, right there. We're not quite there yet. That high around looks like what, 1.0070, perhaps 1.0075. We managed to surpass that over time. I'd watch for that orange trend line I just pointed to. Let's take a look at a closer look at what the origins of that. There you go. This is a daily chart. I notice daily charts rather busy. Lots of horizontal lines, even a couple of other trend lines. But you should be able to see amidst the mess or confusion, the highs that I'm circling now on this daily chart is the basis for that orange trend line. Perhaps that comes into play, if not today, then sometime over the course of this week. You know what I do notice on this daily chart? No, maybe it's easier to see on a 4-hour chart. Yeah, what I do notice, look at the, it's actually, let me minimize the green trend line. Don't want to totally eliminate it because it perhaps might come into play later. I'm just going to make it thinner. Yeah, what I'm struck by on this daily chart is, well, put it simply, the parity area. Call it like 99.70, 99.80 up to parity. You see the highs established mid-June at or not far from 1.0, otherwise known as parity. And of course this recent bounce not too far below parity. I suspect there's a fib level near there too. Perhaps a 38.2% fib nearby of the move from the June 1st low there to the recent high on the upper right-hand part of the chart right there. Yeah, pretty close. The 38.2% fib retracement level of that move up, again from the June 1st low to the high of the month thus far, at 38.2% fib retracement level represented by the black horizontal line that I'm pointing to right now. So there's a nice example of call it roll reversal plus a bounce at a fib level. And you know, maybe there's more to it than meets the eye. I haven't even looked at charts with indicators. I'm sure one of you had even already spotted a pivot point or something like that. Anyway, for now, the Aussie flirting with its previous high today. Yeah, true, Alex. I would agree with that. Alex says a big test will be the fib of the little drop. We We talked about the bounce up on the dollar yen recently. Let's take a look at the yen cross and see what's happening with us. In fact, actually, I haven't even looked at the yen cross. I did talk about the dollar yen, but not specifically the yen cross. I mentioned it, but haven't shown these charts. Here we go. Yeah, we did see the yen rally earlier that I mentioned, but we've seen the yen weaken, interestingly enough, since the particularly since the bounce in the dollar yen at that trend line. And mainly a bit choppy, but I'll tell you, we mentioned the euro weakness earlier, particularly against the dollar. Well, it's not just the dollar the euro's been weak against. So, you know, given the recent, since the dollar yen severs its highs for the day, the recent yen strength, plus the signs of broad euro weakness as well. Not crazy, as I've been yapping about other things here, not crazy to take a shot at a short on the euro yen based on a retest of those lows. Around the 99.30 area. Now, hopefully, there's more to the trade than just that, but that would be a start. A start that is for justifying that trade. Part of me is afraid we're due for a deeper retracement than what we've already seen, though. That is a deeper retracement of the yesterday's move down. And you know what also helps? Look at the forest and the trees here. As I zoom out to a four-hour chart showing price action over the course of this entire month, look at today's lows. Not too far from the lows I'm highlighting now, established in the middle of the month. So if you're concerned that the yen rally has run its course, and it's very possible it has, given the history of the Japanese yen's move in response to news or fundamentals as it relates to Japan. Remember, we've seen occasions, I've discussed this before, we've seen occasions where the Japanese yen has shown unique strength or unique weakness relative to or seemingly sparked by events in Japan. I've mentioned in a recent blog post, over the past several weeks, I actually referenced in a couple of different blog posts over the past several weeks how we've seen some unique yen strength or weakness in the vicinity of a couple of notable Bank of Japan policy meetings. And then my point being that sometimes the Japanese yen does seem to be influenced by things happening in Japan, by and large, the appetite for the Japanese yen, whether it's strength or weakness, appetite for the Japanese yen, by and large, steered by global risk appetite. If there's a risk on mood, if global equities are broadly rising, Japanese yen usually weak. Japanese yen, tends to show strength in a risk-off environment when global equities are dropping. Now, as I mentioned earlier, we haven't seen, at least last I checked, I haven't seen really anything convincing, either risk-on or risk-off. Checking the Bloomberg Market Monitor, it's not real-time, but you know, given the feed I have, the feed I have shows the CAC 40, for example, up marginally, up just more than 0.1%. Germany's DAX up about 0.25%. I noticed the FTSE up about 0.1%. Yeah, actually, I've got the CNBC showing the CAC 40 at an unchanged for the day. Spain's IBEX 35 down only 0.1%. The DAX, Germany's DAX up 0.1%. actually 0.15%. So we haven't seen, there hasn't been that much action in European markets. In the U.S. 10-year yield, for example, basically unchanged on the day. Now, I'm not saying the Japanese yen can't rally further from here or beyond what it's already done today. But for the moment, you certainly don't have anything in the European major European financial markets to support your basis for whatever your basis is for whatever the Japanese yen will do. So hopefully, as the European trading day unfolds, and specifically as the New York trading day gets going, hopefully we'll get some guidance when it comes to the Japanese yen. Some guidance in terms of some sort of risk on or risk off mood. I say hopefully because, again, the history of the Japanese yen showing sustained moves in response to events in Japan isn't that good. If you're watching a recording of this video, I encourage you to check out the FX Bootcamp website. A lot of they're all good, different kinds of content there. Trading lessons, videos, content on the blog. One of the new pieces on the blog posted last week by our chief currency coach Roy McDonald is an overview of our newly relaunched mentorship program.